So I've been short history, about 7-8 years, working with different marine organisms and how they're affected by changing environments, specifically ocean acidification and climate change. In the past, I worked with deep-sea corals in the Gulf of Mexico, and after that, it was working with barnacles up in New Jersey, and now it's all kind of led up to my PhD project of working with tropical marine macroalgae on Florida Key Reefs. So I'm interested in how macroalgae on a reef is going to be affected by increases of temperature and increases of CO2. And so when I first came into this project, I was kind of thinking, why is macroalgae important? Like, okay, I've already studied all these other organisms, but like, why should we care about how this organism is going to respond? And it's important to know for this study, I guess, the different kind of groups we can group them as. So we have calcifying algae. These form calcium carbonate structures, just like corals do. And we have non-calcifying fleshy groups, like sargassum that piles up here on the beach. Just keep that in mind. There are these two different groups, and they actually have two different ecological roles on the reef. Katie, that's right.
What are macroalgae as opposed to microalgae and other kinds of algae?
Yeah, good question, Matt. And by the way, yeah, just shout out questions, it's fine. Macro just means you can see with your naked eye. It's big enough to see with your naked eye. And algae itself is just the kind of a general term for anything that's photosynthesizing in water or in general. So they're kind of like marine plants, but they're not as developed as plants themselves. So marine plants that are in the ocean, such as seagrass, were actually evolved on land and then moved back into the ocean. And so marine macroalgae never actually left the ocean. And macro just means you can see it. It's big enough to see, that's macroalgae. Why is macroalgae important on a coral reef? Why should we care about it? Well, everyone probably could guess this one. It's a primary food resource for all herbivores on the reef. Okay. Stuff you might not know or might not be as obvious, it actually provides settlement for coral, fish, and other invertebrate larvae. So this pink stuff is crustose coralline algae, or like CCA as we call it. And it actually sends out these settlement cues that tell coral larvae that this is a good place to settle and start growing. So this is really important on a reef for further development of the reef. It's also important for reef accretion. And all this is that the algae is growing in between corals, and the reef is building up over geological time. This forms over many, many, eons. It's a very long time, but this reef accretion is really important for the geological growth of the reef. And all the macroalgae are major sediment producers on the reef, and actually the sediment on our beaches, the sand we have on our beach. And they actually provide these complex three-dimensional structures that act as habitat for many organisms on our reef. And even sargassum, as annoying as it may seem on the beach, out in the ocean, it actually is habitat for sea turtles and many other creatures. But there are other factors about macroalgae on a reef that we need to keep in mind. It's a major competitor for light and space on a reef. This picture did not come out well, but you can see it's very, very cluttered, and this is macroalgae and coral. It's kind of just like fighting for space and light on a reef. And over here we have a species of macroalgae, Dictyota, that I work with, and it's just kind of overtaking everything on the reef. And so you can see that macroalgae plays this very intricate role in a very complex system, and this might be easily changed once we start changing the environment it's in, which we are doing by releasing CO2 to the atmosphere. So climate change is potentially going to change all these really important things that it does on a reef. So a major part of the project that I work on, and I have in my entire short scientific career, is ocean acidification. And I think we play a game, but anytime I say ocean acidification, you have a drink, let's drink, because we're going to say it a bunch.
Wait, then I got to go to the bar.
ocean acidification?
Greek.
So we're releasing all this CO2 to the atmosphere, and we've been taking direct measurements from the atmosphere since the late 50s, and we've been seeing a steady increase until the present day. And now, where we are in the present day, 400 parts per million, that's the highest it's been in the atmosphere in the past 800,000 years.
Wow.
And we know this because we can go backwards in time by taking like ice cores in Antarctica and looking at little gas bubbles that are in the ice cores of a specific time way back 800,000 years ago and see what the CO2 concentration was in the atmosphere, and we can also tell the temperature of the atmosphere during that time. And then we can tell what it's going to be like in the future by models that computers generate. And it's projected to reach, by the end of this century, the year 2100, it's projected to reach 1100, right now it's at 400. It's supposed to reach 1100 to 1200, which is the highest it's going to be in the past 10 million years. This is a lot of CO2. So where does all this CO2 go? So since the late 80s, we've been measuring CO2 in the ocean. We've seen a steady increase of CO2 going in the oceans. The ocean is actually buffering what's happening in the atmosphere. It's absorbing the CO2, and that is changing the pH of the ocean. So as a kind of a byproduct of absorbing the CO2 into the ocean, it's actually driving down pH. And this could be a problem for many marine organisms, but in particular, marine calcifiers that rely on pH to form their calcium carbonate structures. And there's like a lot of other studies going on with how it's going to affect fish and attracting, or we don't worry about that, never mind. Okay, so why do marine calcifiers, let's use algae for example, why do they care about the pH of the surrounding seawater to form their calcium carbonate structures? Well, it turns out, in order to form calcium carbonate, and so this is one example, this is Halimeda, which is very plentiful on these reefs here. If you zoom in to right on the surface of the algae, you find these little pockets. And inside these little pockets, they have this separation of the sea from the seawater, and they're able to increase the pH inside this little pocket so high that it actually just starts precipitating calcium carbonate, these little needle formations. And so if it requires a high pH in this little pocket, if you decrease the pH in the surrounding environment, it might be much harder to keep that high pH to form this calcium carbonate structure. And another example, this is Jania, and you can see it's a different color, it's branching, it's not kind of this lobe shaped, and they actually form calcium carbonate a different way. It's kind of on the surface, and you can see it forms in much different shapes and everything. And so it doesn't have these pockets, and actually we think that this one might be more susceptible to ocean acidification because it doesn't have this like separation from the surrounding seawater. So it's really important that they increase pH in order to form calcium carbonate in these microenvironments separated from seawater. And so if we're decreasing pH, it might be much harder for them to do that. So what do we know right now about how ocean acidification is going to affect these calcifiers? The short answer is we don't really know much at all, because a lot of studies have shown negative results, so decreased growth. Some studies have actually shown they've actually increased growth, they've grown more, and other studies have shown there's no effect at all. So there's really no consensus of how ocean acidification is going to affect macroalgae. And if you add in increased temperature, it just makes things more complicated. Some studies have shown it makes the effects of ocean acidification worse, and other studies have shown like it's actually canceled it out. If you increase temperature, that species Halimeda has been shown to increase photosynthesis and actually reverse or cancel out the effects of ocean acidification. So we don't really know the interactive effects of these two major problems. And now, if we forget about calcifiers for a second, look at fleshy algae. This algae does not form this calcium carbonate structure. They don't necessarily care about the pH. So we actually think there's going to be no effect at all, or actually they're just going to increase growth because of the extra CO2. They might be able to use that for photosynthesis and grow even more. So we think these people, this algae might become like a nuisance species. And reefs today, we can tell how healthy they are by the ratio, as many of you probably know. Yes, sir.
I just got a quick question for you. When you look back before 1950s-ish,
yes,
or in the ice cores and all that stuff, has anybody shown that the pH then stabilized?
So the main thing with the change in pH and CO2 in the atmosphere today is not the, like, the big changes, it's how fast it's changing. So it's like unprecedented of how fast it's changing in this short amount of time. So it's been much lower, been much higher, and stabilized, but the main thing is these corals grow so slow, they can't adjust however they grow or calcify because it's changing so fast. Yeah, so we could tell if a reef is healthy by the ratio of calcified coral and calcified algae to fleshy algae. So reefs today, this is a healthy reef with primarily calcified organisms, and we might be shifting to a more dominant fleshy algae reef. Yeah.
So what you're saying is I've been teaching these people all wrong, and then we're not undergoing a phase change to an algae-dominated reef from a coral-dominated reef, but we're changing from a calcifying reef to a fleshy.
That's a possibility. So I'm only talking about two stressors, temperature and ocean acidification, and in relation to those two, this is something that could happen. There's so many other things we have to consider, overfishing and, you know, disease and all these other things that increase temperature, there's increased disease too. So it's hard to say, but I guess that's what I'm getting into, is how these guys are probably going to respond to these changes in the environment. Yeah.
I am surprised that a straight chemist can't simply ask the question, okay, how fast do the calcification reactions occur at different pHs?
Yeah.
Or different temperatures? And
that's exactly what I'm trying to do. The problem is, that's chemistry, and it is a chemical reaction that's happening, but it's a biological organism that's making this chemical environment. It's changing the chemical environment. So we have to see what its limitations are, and like I said, there's other factors we got to consider. So it's really hard to say, you know? So for my study, since, like, remember, there's no consensus of how these organisms are going to respond, so I want to get a kind of a broad perspective of what's going to happen for the reefs in Florida. So I'm studying 9 different species. These are four fleshy. Dictyota, it's everywhere here, little caiman I've seen. It's everywhere in Florida. So this has already been, like, kind of flagged as a potential nuisance species. Lorentzia is kind of in the same boat. Acanthophora, on the west coast of the States, it's actually an invasive species over there, so it'd be good to know how that's going to respond to climate change. And of course, sargassum, which is relatively understudied and important for habitat, but we're seeing this huge sargassum bloom, so we need to know how it's going to respond to increased temperature and CO2. So, and then the other side of the coin would be the calcifying species, and I want to get a broad kind of view of how just calcifiers are doing. So I have different morphologies. You can see, like, these branching types, encrusting, they form these lobe types, and so, like, there's also greens and reds that we gotta keep in mind as algae geeks of how they might respond. And so they also have different ecological roles on the reef. So these guys are the ones that produce the sand because they have this high segment turnover. These segments fall into the sand and they break down and become the carbonate sand. And this is the encrusting algae that corals will settle on, and it actually acts as a glue that holds the reef together. So it's really important to know how, in general, all of these calcifiers are doing. So in order to look at that, we built this system up in Boca Raton in Florida, and there's 40 different tanks, and we want to kind of mimic what's going to happen by the year 2100. So in 10 of the tanks, we have our control. We don't change anything. That's what's happening today. And another 10 tanks, we increase CO2 to what's supposed to happen by the year 2100. And then we also increase temperature, and then look at both of the interactions of those effects. And you can see a close-up of our species in here, and we keep them in there for about 2 weeks to a month and see how they can grow or photosynthesize. And so what I've seen is that actually all the calcifiers are still able to grow and calcify. So now the next question is, how are they doing that? And so to answer that question, we use microsensors. And this is a picture of one of the microsensors. And if you see it close up, the actual tip of this microsensor is the same diameter as a human hair. And this microsensor is made of glass. Like I said, it's the diameter of human hair. And this species isn't so bad, but the other species, it's basically like a rock. And so I'm using these glass hair-sized sensors and trying to lower them down and just pray that they do not break, and they do. They do. And they cost, they're like $1,000 each, and I've broken, I don't even want to say them. So it's a...
More than one.
Yes. They're the size of a hair, and I've been losing hair just working with them. But they can tell us a lot of different things of what's happening. So we measured pH and oxygen right at the surface, and so we can tell how this organism is responding into a changing environment around it, and potentially how it can still calcify or photosynthesize with this changing environment. But so to get an idea of what's happening, so we're measuring pH and oxygen, and we're turning the light on and off. So when you turn the light on, it's photosynthesizing, right? So this blue is oxygen. So as soon as you turn the light on, it starts photosynthesizing and oxygen starts increasing. When that happens as well, the pH starts increasing. Turn the light off and they both just drop. So what we're seeing here, and if you think about this in respects to OA, OA ossification happens because you're adding CO2. This is photosynthesizing. It's removing CO2, so pH is increasing. So we're seeing this kind of very tight relationship to photosynthesis and pH at the surface, which potentially allows calcification. And so if we decrease pH, so this is a scenario of ossification, you can't really tell on this graph, but it's actually increasing pH much higher than it normally does. So in my growth experiment, they're able to still grow. And in this microsensor experiment, we're showing that it's increasing pH much more than it normally does at the surface, because potentially it relies on that pH to calcify. And so like that experiment's based on light. So we're showing that light's really important. Photosynthesis is really important. So here in Middle Cayman, we go to really low light environments. And so we picked up this Halimeda species from underneath these crevices and these rocks. They're getting very little light, and they're still growing down there. And we think that these might respond much differently than species I collected in Florida, just like 10 feet deep in really high light environments. And these species, they might go one way. They may not be able to handle ossification just as well as my species do here in Florida, or they might go the other way because they're so adapted to these low light scenarios that they can handle these changes in their environments. Oh, and we have these like cool sensors we take out in the field, looks like a light bulb, and we stick it in these crevices and we measure exactly how much light is in there. And then back in the lab, we set our lights to the exact measurements we got in the field and grow them in the lab to see if ossification.